The birth of the dark god Slaanesh created the permanent warp storm known as the Eye of Terror that swept away the ancient Aeldari Empire. But the Aeldari had only themselves to blame for the near extinction of their people. It was their uncontrolled desires for the most perfect experiences that had emanated through the warp, coalescing into a terrible new consciousness. Once awakened, this entity had absorbed the souls of those who embodied its psychic substance, becoming one of the most powerful beings in the warp. Slaanesh was a nightmare born of the Eldari's pursuit of amoral pleasure, but it was not alone. Three other godlike entities had long called the warp home. They, too, had been created from the psychic emanations of the intelligent peoples of the galaxy. They were creatures of pure emotion, unconstrained by reason or order. These dark gods gazed through the window into reality that was the Eye of Terror. They hungered to add the Immaterium and all its souls to their domain. Only one foe stood in their way. Only one being truly possessed the power to destroy them. This was the Emperor of Mankind, who had long foreseen the danger the gods of the warp presented to humanity. But with their power strengthened by the coming of Slaanesh, the gods had also awoken to the danger the Emperor represented. An uneasy alliance soon formed within the warp that plotted to unravel all his designs before they had even begun. Emotions felt by the thinking creatures of the galaxy were projected into the Immaterium as streams of psychic energy. These tended to gather together like water running down a cliff face. Similar feelings slowly came together until they formed streams of desire, pools of hatred, and torrents of pride. As mankind and other peoples confronted the hardships of their lives, they often felt strong emotions, such as rage, fear of death, and the desire for a change in their circumstances, no matter how hopeless. Such was the power of these emotions in the warp that, as happened with Slaanesh, these immense concentrations of psychic energy eventually evolved an intelligence of their own. They became the gods of chaos, great psychic presences within the warp, composed of all the darkest needs and desires of mortals. This pantheon of ruinous powers was often simply called Chaos, a name given by nearly every culture in the galaxy to these malevolent beings. These entities were immensely powerful, and capable of granting portions of this power to mortals who called upon them in the hopes of fulfilling their particular desires. But the Chaos Gods never offered anything for free. For those who bargained with the ruinous powers, the only currency accepted was their soul. Each soul they claimed that embodied a Chaos God's dominant emotion only made them stronger, just as Slaanesh had grown to immense power by devouring the souls of the Eldari. In this way, the Chaos Gods acted very much like the demons of human myth. They offered power in the fulfillment of selfish wishes in return for the bargainer's life force. Yet despite their name, the powers of Chaos were not gods in the true sense, for they held no existence independent of the inhabitants of the mortal plane. Each entity's strength waxed or waned depending on the amount of their preferred emotion emanating from mortals. Should anything ever interrupt that flow, they would wither and die. Time has no meaning in the Immaterium, and so from a certain point of view, all four Chaos Gods have existed since the universe began. Yet it is still possible to identify when mankind began to interact with these entities. Khorne, the Blood God, the Lord of Battle, is the oldest of the Chaos Gods, the first to interact with humanity around the start of the Terran Middle Ages. Khorne was the embodiment of fury and wrath, the surge of rage that a man felt when he slew his enemies with a strong arm and a sharp blade. Every act of killing done in anger fed Khorne, the more senseless and destructive the better. To those willing to offer him their souls, Khorne gave the strength and skill needed to conquer any foe or claim a righteous vengeance. Khorne disdained the use of psychic powers. He wanted his followers to achieve their goals through direct combat, usually with a sharp axe in both hands. Mankind's first contact with the Blood God saw the eruption of the constant but vicious wars that had defined the Dark Ages. Next was Tzeentch, the architect of fate, the god of change, who became known to mankind as the first major kingdoms were forming at the end of the Dark Ages. Any individual who sought a change in their lives, who hoped for or imagined something better, empowered Tzeentch. The Changer of the Ways sought to weave together the threads that connected every plot and intrigue into a galaxy-wide game of manipulation whose ultimate goal was known only to him. The Lord of Change was the source of the old adage that knowledge is power. he offered those willing to worship him secret knowledge that could be used to climb the rungs of success in business or politics. The use of psychic powers produced great change in real space, so Tzeentch particularly favored those who wielded them. It was Tzeentch who most often bargained with mortals for the secrets of sorcery, as the most potent of these abilities were called. Tzeentch's first interactions with humanity were marked by the rise of more sophisticated nations, where political intrigue and the spread of commerce were responsible for rapid changes in the fates of many. Nurgle, the Lord of Decay, was the third of the Chaos Gods to become known to mankind. He was empowered by the most primal of mortal fears, death, but he also embodied the cycle of decay and ultimate rebirth. Plague and pestilence were the Fly Lord's chosen art forms, and despair the emotion that most drew his attention. Wherever life was threatened by disease or decay, the Plague God was there, ready to grant the desperate and dying freedom from their pain and life unending. However, this boon was granted to his worshippers only in a twisted new form, bloated with the corruption to which they were now immune. While Nurgle was a jolly soul who cared for his flock as if they were his own children, it was often one of his own plagues that was responsible for the suffering he cured. Nurgle was first drawn to humanity during the late Middle Ages, when the Black Plague snuffed out millions of lives and misery came to define daily life. These three Chaos Gods ruled for many long millennia as the greatest powers of the warp. They waged an eternal war against each other for total dominance both within the warp and in real space, known among their followers as the Great Game. They were joined at last in this sport by Slaanesh, the god of selfish pleasure. Though She Who Thirsts had been born of Aeldari souls, it soon sought equal prey among mankind. This was true of all the Dark Gods, for mortals whose desires were intense enough and matched the Ruinous Powers' own ruling passions could create a conduit between the warp and real space. If the worshipper agreed of their own free will to serve the interests of the god, they received boons from their new master. These provided the necessary power or knowledge to achieve their goals. In return, the god laid claim to that person's soul, increasing their own strength and reach in the warp. Of course, the gods of chaos were fickle and uncaring of what happened to their mortal servants. They often showed their favor by imposing disfiguring mutations as gifts upon their minions that enhanced their abilities. But any failure in the eyes of chaos could spell doom for a mortal. They could be condemned to uncontrolled mutation into a gibbering monstrosity, death, or the consumption of their soul within the warp. But far worse was the fate of psykers who came to the attention of the Ruinous Powers. Psykers were born with the ability to make a direct, two-way connection to the warp, so that their minds existed for a time in both realms. Mortal souls were usually seen by the inhabitants of the Immaterium as pinpricks of light. But psykers appeared as blazing torches, drawing the Chaos God's servants like moths to a flame. The Ruinous Powers had many such servants in the warp, entities later called demons by mortals. While each was an independent being, they were created from one of the four gods' psychic essences and were no more than extensions of their will. However, demons would gleefully possess the body of a psyker who was weak-willed or whose powers were uncontrolled. The possessed psyker's mind served as a bridge for them into real space. Reality was like a playground to demons, who sought to reshape it to match their master's own nightmare domains, no matter the damage inflicted. It was this phenomenon which had unleashed so many of the horrors of the Age of Strife on humanity. Only psykers of the strongest will, or whose minds had been strengthened by the Emperor's soul binding, could resist the constant temptations of chaos demons to let them into the mortal world. These incursions into reality had always been of limited duration and scope, until Slaanesh's birth ripped open the Eye of Terror and the smaller warp rifts that followed in its wake. For the first time, the entities of the warp could exist openly within these rifts without having to possess a mortal body. What they saw of reality made the Ruinous Powers hunger all the more for control of it. The Eye of Terror came to embody their ultimate goal. They would break down the barriers between the Materium and the Immaterium, the real and the unreal, until the Eye of Terror had grown to encompass all of creation. The Dark Gods would gain direct control over the mortals who created and sustained their power. They would guarantee an unending flow of souls to feed their endless hunger. But one obstacle stood in the way of this diabolical plot: the Emperor of Mankind. The Emperor, who existed wholly in the warp as well as real space, had long known of the Dark God's existence, and he understood how human emotions and desires fed their power. He knew that their demonic servants used psychers to gain entry to the material realm. All of his efforts during the Unification Wars had been intended to weaken the Chaos God's power to the point that mankind no longer served as their playthings. The Emperor had restored civilization and its foundations of reason and logic to human society. He and Malkador had educated the people of Terra to solve their problems rationally rather than just giving in to uncontrolled emotions like fear and fury. Such passions only fed the ruinous powers. He had exposed religion as unfounded superstition, suppressing the absurd beliefs used by the demagogues of the Age of Strife to spread worship of the Chaos Gods in multiple guises. The Emperor had required all human psychers to be soulbound, reshaping their minds to resist attempts by demons to use them as portals into real space. He had built the Astronomicon, not only to provide a beacon for his navigators, but to project his own will, his own order, directly into the warp. This power was a psychic strain of reason that was the anathema of the uncontrolled emotions that define chaos. It injured and weakened the influence of the Dark Gods wherever its light fell in the Immaterium. And finally, the Emperor had created the Primarchs, 20 warriors, generals, and statesmen without peer to aid him in his quest to bring the entire galaxy under his control. They would lead his effort to reclaim humanity's future among the stars, a future forever free of chaos. It was Tzeentch who first recognized the danger posed by the Emperor. If the Emperor and his Primarchs were successful in uniting mankind, they would cut chaos off from the source of psychic power that fed its very existence. It was rare that the Chaos Gods ever faced a threat great enough to force unity among them, but in this case they acted as one. Yet the Primarch's gestation capsules, kept safe in the Emperor's gene labs, had been encased in the greatest physical and psychic protections the Emperor could devise. Khorne could not slay them. Nurgle could not sicken them. Tzeentch, despite all his knowledge, could not unmake them. And so they combined their powers to take the only action possible. The Chaos Gods stole the still unborn Primarchs away from their father, casting them through the warp to different worlds scattered across the galaxy. Despite all their power, they could do nothing more to derail the Emperor's plans than deprive him of the chance to raise and guide his sons. It would have to be enough. 20 demigods intended to serve as humanity's greatest heroes and the Emperor's proconsuls, they would instead be raised by other fathers under distant stars. They would come of age on worlds shattered by old night, environments that would shape them into men defined by strife and hardship. They would lack the compassion and vision their father had meant to share with them from their first breath. But the loss of his sons did not stay the Emperor's course. He had found other ways to unite Terra and then the Sol system. But as his great fleet prepared to journey into the interstellar void for the first time, he looked out into the darkness and wondered if he might yet find his lost children.